Hi, everyone. This is Dr. Cheryl Filmon, and welcome to What Women Must Know. Thank you for joining me for the opportunity to have another wonderful in-depth conversation that really will help to transform your life. This program is all about empowering you with truthful information so you can make the best decisions regarding your health and well-being and really know how to navigate through your life so you can achieve the experiences, the sense of well-being, certainly a greater mission, purpose in life. So thank you so much for joining me. And I always like to welcome people who may be listening for the very first time. It's nice to have you here. I do want to let you know that my shows are archived, and the best way to get them is to either like me on my Facebook page, which is What Women Must Know, or to just opt in, subscribe on my website, which is drcherylselman.com, because I post on my Facebook page the shows on a weekly basis, and I also send them to your inbox if you opt into Dr. Cheryl Selman every week. And that is the best way to be sure to catch every single show, which I always recommend you do. And also, I have a second show on Progressive Radio Network every Saturday at 11 a.m. called The Love Code. And that is a show dedicated for spiritual upliftment, I would say. And my guests are amazing people who are living and bringing into their physical reality the miracles that are possible when we connect to our spirit and to our soul. So it's a very inspiring program. And if you are around 11 a.m. on Saturday mornings on Progressive Radio Network, please tune in. Or if you just like me at What Women Must Know or go to Dr. Cheryl Selman, those shows will be sent to you as well. So you won't miss out on anything, and you don't want to miss out. They're all fantastic. And I'm so grateful to the wonderful guests that I have that inspire me on a weekly basis, and I know they are inspiring you as well. So thanks for joining me again. And we have another incredibly inspiring guest today. We're going to be talking about a topic that is really one of my favorite topics. It's a topic actually that I do lecture about in my own way, and it's a topic that I am forever fascinated by, and I'm sure most of you will be as well, because we're talking about aging backwards. Don't you love that concept? I always say I'm getting younger and healthier with every year. So we're going to be exploring how to age backwards gracefully with my guest, Miranda Esmonde-White. And let me just share a little bit about Miranda. She is a New York Times bestselling author and one of America's greatest advocates and educators for healthy aging. Following her career as a professional ballerina, Miranda developed her own fitness technique called Essentrics in 1997 and became the flexibility trainer to numerous professional and Olympic athletes and celebrities. And Miranda's award-winning PBS documentaries, Aging Backwards, Aging Backwards 2, and Forever Painless, are revolutionizing the way we understand the role that fitness plays in slowing down the aging process while keeping our bodies feeling young, strong, and healthy. And that's the most important thing we all want, is to slow down the aging process and keep our bodies feeling young, strong, and healthy. So it is my great pleasure to welcome Miranda Esmonde-White to the show. Hello, Miranda.
Hello, Dr. Selman, and thank you so much for inviting me.
Well, it's a pleasure, and I'm really looking forward to our conversation, because truly, aging backwards is the most important thing we need to understand, and we need to know how to put into our daily life the strategies that help us. And, you know, there are many strategies, there are many things that we need to do to age backwards, to get younger and healthier, as I like to say. But understanding our body and how to work with our body is certainly one of the critical things we need to understand. So can I just start, Miranda, by asking you to share a little bit about your own personal journey and how you came to really do this work and find this as your mission?
Oh, I'd love to. First of all, I just had my 70th birthday, and I feel younger and healthier and fitter at the age of 70 than I did when I was 30. I mean, I am feeling terrific, and I'm still working full-time, which is like more than full-time, and traveling a lot and just enjoying life. So pain-free, fully energetic. So that, to me, is what being youthful is all about. So just to give you a tiny little background, I was a professional ballerina and broke my foot very badly, which ended that career. I was with the National Ballet of Canada, so I toured around the world, which was a lot of fun. I love ballet, still do, but it's very, very hard on the body. Like, mm-hmm. Ballet dancers are professional athletes, basically. So I tried different careers, marketing and that, and ended up opening up a dance and fitness center around the Jane Fonda era. Love Jane Fonda. Ended up with incredibly bad back pain, chronic back pain, the type that paralyzed me. I was in bed for a week or two at a time, and continuous spasms, continuous back pain attacks for a few years. And I decided to, my students also, we were all doing aerobics with the weights on the ankles and step aerobics, and people became bulkier looking. The women, because it was mainly women that were doing this back then, started to get a very bulky sort of look to their bodies. And I was used to having that long, lean ballet look, and my body was looking bulky. So I had developing a bulky look and back pain. So I decided to create a program, and my students wanted to get the long, lean ballet look. So I worked on creating a program to give that long, lean look to the body that ballet dancers have. And to cut many, many years, a long story, I created a program that develops the muscles to be long and lean. And when you develop long, lean muscles, you're actually lengthening the muscles so that they have that ballet look. Because ballet dancers, as opposed to any other dance form, is in very elongated movements, long straight legs, you know, these split leaps with straight knees, not bent knees. You know, so there's a lot of straightening and bending and using the full skeleton, all 360 joints in the body. They're always being moved in ballet. So it was a flexibility program. I thought when I created it, I thought I had created a flexibility program because we were stretching. But it actually is a strengthening program. That was the part that I didn't realize at the time, that I created a strengthening program, but that liberated every joint, giving every joint its full range of motion. So we thought, because you have full range of motion, that the program was about flexibility, but actually it's about strengthening, which we need for energy. You need to be strong to be able to, you need power and endurance to make it through your daily life, you know. Not maximum, but enough to make it through whatever you want to do as a normal person. So that's basically how I created the program. And in the process, 3 months into creating it, my back pain disappeared. And a lot of the students in my studio who were doing the program, my guinea pigs, I called them, they started to lose their arthritis in their knees. Their knee pain went away, their back pain, all kinds of pains, not one particular pain, but general pain disappeared. So I had no idea why at the time. So I had to go back to school and reverse, instead of learning first and creating after. I created first and then worked on the science and the anatomy and, you know, the physiology after. So does that answer your question?
Yeah. It's so fascinating, though, because there are so many theories about what we need to do to keep our body strong and healthy, and how best to do that. And certainly, you know, the older you get, the more prone you are to having injuries or discomfort mm-hmm. occur in the body, but you know, there are just so many prevailing thoughts about what we need to do to stay healthy. So many people, you know, as we're baby boomers are in their 60s and 70s and beyond, we all want to stay healthy and fit and
right.
young. You know, and when you're healthy, as you were describing yourself, you really are ageless because
right.
you only feel
right.
old
yeah.
if you're achy, right, or in pain.
Yeah, that's right.
So
if you can't move, then you feel old. Yeah. Achy and pain and can't move, can't get in and out of a car, can't put your clothes on easily. You know, yeah, that's when you feel old. And so if you can do all those things, then you're not feeling old. You can't identify with your age unless, you know, I mean, I have wrinkles. So that exercise can't fix the wrinkles on the face.
No,
but
wrinkles are inconsequential to having a life
yeah,
that
yeah.
really allows you to be vital and get out and, you know, and enjoy
and
participate,
you know,
right?
Wrinkles and the aging of a woman and a man's face, I find now that I'm getting older, if you're aging properly and you're young, youthful feeling and healthy, and you've got an older face because it's got some wrinkles on it, beautiful. I find women who are older absolutely beautiful, and men can be so good looking when they're healthy and when they're fit
yeah.
and when they're, you know, it's, so that there's a beauty in the aging process. It's not gone. It's even maybe greater because there's the richness in the person's face that shows their life.
And if you're feeling well, you have access to that vitality, and that comes
yeah.
through
yeah.
who you are
yeah.
and how you operate
yeah.
in the world, right? So it's so important to understand our bodies. You know, it's just such a blinding flash of the obvious to me that our consciousness lives in the physical. And we take care of our car with great, you know, concerns,
right.
making
yeah.
sure we're
mm-hmm.
changing the oil and, you know, getting mm-hmm. it into the garage and, you know, making sure everything is fine-tuned. And here we are, this, our consciousness, our spirit, our soul, however you want to define it, it inhabits this physical expression. And we need to understand that it requires the same kind of love and attention and care, which seems like an obvious statement to make, but when you look at how people deal with their bodies and how they so identify with their bodies and also really abuse their bodies, and
well,
there is no way
issue.
You're
going to
have a healthy, vital body, right, if you are abusing
no.
it in any way, shape, or form.
Well, the thing that I've learned over these years is that the science literally was not there until recently as to why we aged. So when we were doing those old aerobic things, we didn't know what we were actually doing to the body. There was connective tissue is such a new science that it wasn't in medical textbooks. They didn't have connective tissue in medical anatomy textbooks until about 10, 15 years ago. I mean, it's so recent that when they dissected cadavers, they would remove the connective tissue in order to get at what was real. And yet now there's an explosion of research on connective tissue in this last decade showing how absolutely essential understanding and maintaining healthy connective tissue is to every aspect of our life. Movement, it ages us when our connective tissue starts to gum up. We get stiff. We thought that was muscles. No, it's connective tissue. You know, all these things that literally wasn't available to our parents and wasn't even available to us until recently. So it's no wonder that we've been ruining our bodies with the and all the university programs that are in kinesiology and teaching fitness and sports. They are teaching the old stuff that actually ages the body because this science is so new that it hasn't caught up. If you've graduated, then you didn't get this knowledge. You weren't trained in how muscles work, how atrophy happens, how connective tissue affects every aspect of movement. So, you know, what you're saying is, you know, we should take care of our bodies the way we take care of, like, our cars and our homes, and yet we didn't even know how to or what our bodies were. So we didn't know what we had to take care of until recently.
That's so interesting. So can you help us understand more about connective tissue and its role in keeping us fit and youthful?
Well, connective tissue is, it's so obvious, that's why we missed it, is that it connects absolutely everything, every part to every other part of our body. Connective tissue surrounds every cell, and we've got tens of trillions of cells, all different types of cells, like nerve cells, bone cells, skin cells, blood cells, you name it. But they're all surrounded by something to make them a unique cell. And that is connective tissue, a collagenous type tissue. And not only is it surrounded, but inside it's also lined by connective tissue. All our nerves, our brain cells, everything is surrounded by connective tissue. So there is not one part of our body that is not touched, connected, by, made of connective tissue. And then if you don't move, this connective tissue can start gumming up. It needs continuous movement. The human body is designed to move. A baby comes out of the womb and it's, you know, it's flailing away. We're designed to move. We have joints and muscles. They're there to move us, so that if we didn't have joints, nothing could move. So the joints bend and straighten, and the muscles move everything. So we are created to move, and the movement is what keeps everything healthy. It's a brilliant system. It's like genius. I find the human body very spiritual. So that the more you move, the healthier your body will be. But then if you overdo the type of movement, you will destroy your body, such as, you know, when you do these CrossFit's really hard on the body. Ballet is really hard on the body. Football, you know, these things destroy the body. We know that. We love doing them. I love ballet. I don't do it anymore. But these are all very hard on the body, and I could explain to you why. But, you know, the compression of the joints that's damaging the joints. But the joints are designed, everything in our body is designed to last our entire lifetime. We are not supposed to have the need for any joint replacements, or, you know, our spine is just fine. It's not designed to get arthritis. Our knees, our hips, they're not designed to need to be replaced. They're created to make it through our whole life. Muscles also. And it's the connective tissue that maintains all these things, so that surrounding them, there's the connective tissue that comes in a filmy form, very, very thin, and it, in connective tissue of that type, has a little bit of flexibility, but not much, but it slides over layers of other connective tissue. So there's this liquidy layer. It's not really liquidy, but that's the best way to describe it. That's between.
It's kind of slimy. Would you say it's like slimy. A slimy wetness?
Yeah. And absolutely. And it needs to be moved all the time. It needs, every day you need to move every single joint and muscle in your body. You don't need to move them a lot. That's the catch. It's so easy to keep yourself young. You don't have to do crazy exercise. So you just have to move around, wiggle and twist and bend and stretch and reach and turn and, you know, just lift your arms above your head, so that this stuff does not glue up. But once the connective tissue starts gluing up, it hardens, and then you can't move. So that's why as you get older, over the years, the layers slowly gum up, and then you can't move so easily, and then that creates, it's a cascading effect of that leads to pain, that leads to compression of your joints, that leads to joint damage, imbalanced bodies. So if you keep your connective tissue healthy, you will have a balanced body, because you have to move everything in your body to keep it healthy. So that will keep all your muscles balanced, your connective tissue healthy, and it will also keep your body's shape. And the shape of our body, you know, you see young people have a specific shape, and if people don't exercise, their body just gets flabby looking. But the flabby look is because the connective tissue has lost its form. So as you exercise, you have to reform the deformed connective tissue. So connective tissue takes time to reform. Muscles can strengthen in one day. Connective tissue can take weeks and weeks. So this is where people always thought it was their muscles they were working. It is, but it's also their connective tissue, because the connective tissue is what actually gives the shape. So the connective tissue is like the skeleton of a house, and the muscles are what's going on inside it. But if the house, you know, if the house starts falling apart, it's just sort of like crumbling, that's the connective tissue.
It's so interesting, the whole world of, yeah, this connective tissue world. I was told that if you lost your skin, if you just your skin melted away, people would still recognize you because the connective tissue, because it's covering every aspect of yourself, still will allow people to recognize you.
If they removed your bones and your organs and just left the connective tissue, you would have a complete coat of armor. That would be you. Just like you're saying, it would hold you up because that's the formation of your body.
It's fascinating. The other thing that I learned with the work that I do, that is that when you have any sort of incision in the body, if you have any surgery, if there's anything that punctures the skin, you potentially can damage the connective tissue, and it kind of gets dried out and leathery and can create adhesions or can interfere with the energy flow in other organs of your body. So it's really important to heal scars. And
you're 100% right about that.
Right? You know, so
there's technology that I use.
I just want to say there's technology that I use, microcurrent technology at certain frequencies that actually can restore the interference field, which is created through any type of puncture or incision in the skin. And I've had people talk about this on my show, about scars and the impact of scars on connective tissue and how the connective tissue is a superhighway that is communicating at the speed of light to the brain. So this is a big story here, Miranda.
Absolutely. There's one of the leading researchers, the first person to really the first scientist, Dr. Hélène Langevin, back 40 years ago when she was doing her PhD in Oxford, I think, she became recognized as the first person to identify in acupuncture the meridians that followed the connective tissue flow. And she's the one that opened up the whole world of connective tissue. Everything we're talking about now is because she started that. So she was in Burlington, and then she was the director of integrated medicine at Harvard, and now she's the head of integrated medicine, the whole research department at the NIH in Bethesda. So she's very, very senior, and she talks all about exactly what you're saying. So one of her researches was on scar tissue, exactly what you're talking about, where they proved that stretching will return the scar tissue, which is on the fibers, like the connective tissue fibers, the muscle fibers, return the fibers to their natural flow, because they get deformed and the get all gummed up and cause sort of like an interference in that highway you were talking about, that messaging highway, the movement highway. It causes people to have incredible amounts of pain when they have scar tissue from surgery or injuries, internal scarring. But the scarring is very interesting because she did another research. So she was the first person to prove that stretching returns the scar tissue to a healthy tissue. That was fascinating. But you have to stretch, because if you don't, it gets gooey and gummed up, and the original scar tissue multiplies in size. Because it keeps bunging up the next door neighbor tissue, and then the next door neighbor. So over the years, you get even more bunged up, and that injury becomes a bigger injury over the years. That surgery becomes even worse over the years. The repercussions, you know.
Wow.
But the other thing she worked on was they did research on pigs. So they tied up a front and opposite back leg to some pigs. And she said that these pigs were like living in luxury, like it was like the Ritz-Carlton of pig life. So they tied up the pigs' legs, and that created a massive wadding on the backs, which is what happens to people if they're sedentary or if they don't move, if they only do specific exercises but they don't move their full body. The part that they don't move, the scar tissue will start hardening, and that's also called scar tissue. So it's connective tissue that hardens, and it creates exactly the same thing as though you'd had surgery. There's a blockage in that highway, that messaging highway, or that movement highway in our body that causes back pain. And again, stretching and pulling it out can reverse that. It takes time, but it can reverse it.
You know, this is such a fascinating topic because we are told over and over again how important exercise is, right? Exercise is important to keep our brain healthy. Exercise is important to keep our moods going. Exercise is important so we have, you know, energy. But there are these distinctions about what actually is the best exercise to do, you know, at different stages of one's life. So what are your thoughts about people who are running, you know, just runners in general, people who are running marathons, and what are your thoughts about people who are running and doing that kind of intensive exercise in their 60s and 70s and beyond?
Well, there's no one identical person to another, but the average age of runners, I think in men, it's slightly changing now. It was in men in the United States was it was 38 a couple of years ago, and it might be going up to 39 now, and women was around 34, 35, but it's slightly changing. Those are the average ages. And if you ask why people stop running, it's because they're in pain. So pain is nothing. Pain is a zero. Pain is only a message telling us that there's something wrong with our body. So that means that if you are doing something that's causing pain, then whatever that's doing is causing damage, because pain is just a message, and people don't realize what pain is. It's the one of the greatest gifts that we've been given in our human body is the gift of pain, because it tells us how not to damage our body, how to keep it young. If we're in pain, we have to stop doing what's causing the pain and keep doing everything we can do up until what's causing the pain. If you really love pain, which some people do, go ahead, but you're going to be ruining your body. Know that pain is a message telling you that something is wrong, not that something is right. It's telling you something is wrong. So people keep doing the something wrong, and they damage their bodies more and more and more. The old, the training that's actually, it's not old, people, trainers are still doing this, coaches, is telling people to work through the pain, which is like ludicrous when you realize that pain is a message telling us that something's broken, something's wrong, we have to fix that. So our attitude towards pain is take a painkiller, to, you know, do something, block out the pain, but keep doing the exercises. Like, great, I can take some pills and I can continue running. But if you're in pain, then you're damaging your body. If you're not in pain, then yay, do whatever you want to do. If you're in pain and you want to damage your body, you know, it's your body. But don't expect it to be youthful. At a certain point, the damage will be great. So I know a lot of people in their 50s that run through the pain and end up with blowing their shins, completely blowing the you know, and that's it. Once you've done that, you're it's very hard to even walk. So, you know, you have to be using your wisdom and maybe find things that aren't causing pain. I mean, I exercise doing my program half an hour every day. That's all I do. And I'm in such good shape. I can when I travel, I walk like 10 hours a day. I'm walking like miles, 10 miles a day when I'm on holiday. And zero problem. But what I do generally every day is just half an hour of these sort of movements that keep the connective tissue and the muscles all active. We don't have to over-exercise.
So we don't have to over-exercise to be fit and to have a healthy fit body. So the
that's right.
One of the questions I am curious to ask you is, you know, let's talk about muscle atrophy as we get older, because that's, you know, sarcopenia, as it's called, is a natural process. What do we do to avoid that? And you know, how do we really help to support our metabolism to function in a healthy way?
Well, the metabolism needs the muscles. The muscles have to move to maintain the metabolism as best as possible. And I mean, we're all destined to die. There's not one human that's not. So we know that we're going to age, and our body is going to change as we age. And there will be some degree of muscle atrophy, which is normal as we age. But we've been accepting too much atrophy because we haven't understood that we don't have to atrophy until, but we can slow down the atrophy by just moving. If you move every muscle, then that muscle isn't going to atrophy. You don't have to do it extremely. Just move it. Just do any movement to move. But we have 650 muscles, so you have to move them all, because if you don't move them all, you're going to unbalance. One muscle group will get stronger and the other one will start to atrophy. That's where things like you asked me earlier about walking or running, they don't use the full body. They're wonderful exercises for outdoors and social, but maybe not so good for the full body. So in addition to walking, you need to do full body exercises as well, just to keep everything equally balanced. But you don't need a lot. So the atrophy doesn't have to be extreme until a certain point in our life. And, you know, we will slow down, and that's like considered around the last 6 months of our lives, when everything is slowing down, and that's it. But before that, when we're still alive, into our 90s, into our 90s, even to our 100s, if we haven't wrecked up our body, we can slow down the degree of atrophy, which is normal. There will be a normal degree, but slow it down so that we can still live a very active life.
So do you think we need to do weight training to work with building and maintaining muscle mass? I mean, that's a question I have, because that's been something that I have been doing, at least keeping, you know, arms firm and areas like that. What are your thoughts about that?
My thoughts on weight training I have done and worked with basically every type of athlete, from Olympians, professional hockey players, squash players, ordinary folks like you and I. And I do not believe in weights for anyone but people who are high-performance athletes, and they're going to end up in pain. Because we weigh something. Our physical body is a weight. So if we're bending, if you're bending forward, moving around, moving your skeleton, you are lifting a weight. You are moving a weight. Walking doesn't really move the skeleton. And just like things like bicep curls, they're very specific and located. And you're just doing the biceps, let's say. Very isolated muscle groups. But if you're moving your full body, it takes a lot of strength. Like, I don't know what you weigh, but I'll just say somebody who weighs 150, 130 pounds, whatever, 180, if they bend sideways and then have to lift their body straight, that's a lot of weight. They're bending their entire torso that probably weighs 50 or 60 pounds, the head on top, very heavy, their arms reaching out, and then lifting the whole body up slowly. They're lifting a heavy weight. So all the muscles of their, you know, their obliques, their abdominal muscles, their latissimus dorsi, their spinal erecti, they're all working like mad to lift up that body from a side bend. So there's a lot of weight just in slow, careful movement. If you move quickly, momentum moves the body. But if you move slowly, the slowness requires the muscles to lift the body, so that then you're stressing the bones as you're strengthening the muscles, just moving your own body. So I do not believe in weights, because weights end up compressing the joints, because you have to shorten the muscles to hold the weight. But it's your own body you're lifting. If you're bending sideways, you don't have to shorten. You can lengthen the muscles, because it's not an external weight. It's your body's weight. It knows yourself. So you won't bend more than you're capable of holding. So you'll bend slowly. When your body can't support you and it's going to collapse, it'll stop bending. And then you'll straighten it up. And as you strengthen your trunk, you can bend further and further, because your strength will become increased just by slow side bends or slow rounding and straightening up of the spine, curving your spine, rotating your spine, Tai Chi plies. All these things are done slowly are very strengthening, and you're liberating your joints. So what weights do is compress the joints, because you're having to shorten the muscles. But if you can move slowly, you can lengthen the muscles as you're moving, because you're controlling it with your mind. And so you're stretching, getting the range of motion of that joint without weights. It's very powerful strengthening. Does that answer
that
your question?
That is so interesting, Miranda. Yeah, it's so fascinating, because it's a whole different paradigm to understand how to really support and optimize the functioning of the body, which is what we're all looking for. But
yes,
you know, have to kind of find our way through all the different theories.
Well, I mean, I'm like completely in conflict, let's say, or with every other fitness program, because of what I'm saying. I'm saying, don't work too hard. Be gentle. Do only half an hour. Don't do more than that. You can do an hour, that's okay, but don't do excessive movements. Don't do excessive exercise, because you're going to start damaging your body. And you will be in incredibly good shape just by doing these smooth, gentle, slow movements. It's the slowness that causes the strengthening. And safe. If you move slowly, you're not going to slowly tear a muscle, you know? If you move rapidly, the momentum will tear your muscle before you can stop it. But if you're moving slowly, the moment you're in some pain, you'll say, oh, well, that's it for me. I'm going to straighten up there. So you're not going to injure yourself when you move slowly.
This is great information. So in your new book, Aging Backwards, which then subtitle, Fast Track, Six Ways in 30 Days to Look and Feel Younger. So can you explain a bit of the what's in your book and the approach you are recommending and teaching in the book?
So I wrote this book, this fast track book, with the six ways, because people often said, well, it's such a strange concept, aging backwards. Can you really do it? And they thought it was just a gimmicky name. So I thought, well, I have seen literally hundreds and more like thousands of people follow this formula and literally reverse their lives, get their lives back. I mean, massively get their lives back. So what it is it's the six basic ways that what you have to do in order to successfully age backwards. And if some people don't want to do one of the ways, then they won't get the same results as if they do it exactly according to this book. So there's 30 days of exercises that we give for the different levels of fitness, and six ways. So that's the six ways are the formula. Part of it is you have to work your full 650 muscles, all the connective tissue in your body. So this is the muscular skeletal system and all 360 joints. So you get your bones, your muscles, and your connective tissue. But then we have a large section on the brain, on when we're aging backwards, when we're trying to reverse or maintain our youth, we have to maintain our brain. So there's quite a lot in the ways of the brain part is how do you use exercise to stimulate neurons and strengthen the connections between the synapses. And it's amazing how exercise maintains and rebuilds brain cells. And this is all, there's the science in it. There's all the studies in that. But by doing things like your imagination is so powerful, a powerful means of strengthening your muscles. When I never even knew that, strengthening your brain as you strengthen your muscles. So I'll give you an example. Like if you were to reach up and pick an apple, so you'd reach up, arm would go up in the air, you'd have to grab the apple, so your hand has to decide, like an apple weighs what, you know, not too much, so you have to twist it away from the tree and pull it down from the tree. You're not lifting 50 pounds, you're lifting a very light weight, right? And it's got a certain shape. So by giving that command, so tell people different commands, different imagination things, the mind has to immediately go to work imagining how to pick an apple. So first it sees a tree, then it has you reach up, but you're not going to reach up too far because you want to be able to get the apple, and then you're going to grab the apple, but not too tight so that you squish the apple and not too loosely so it would fall out of your hand. So there's a lot of commands that the brain is sending to your body, and all those commands build neurons. So by giving imagination in these exercises, and so we give a lot of imagery because we know that imagery is building brain cells. So we're using this exercise program to work on the brain. So by actually putting in, when I started learning and working on the with scientists about the brain, it was so amazing. We just threw more and more imagery into the movements so that instead of saying lift your arm and grab, you have to put the imagery in so your brain has to work at it. And that's just one part. But the other part is that if you bend over, the brain has to figure out how, let's say you're going to bend sideways again. The brain has to figure out how far can you bend without falling on your face. You know, so it's got to figure out your weight, your place in space, how which muscles will hold you your feet solidly on the ground as you bend over, which muscles are required to lower you and which ones are required to lift you. So that's a secondary part that the brain is working. So it works on imagination, and then it has to work on the actual muscle commands. So that by giving slow movements, it's very stimulating to the brain. So that's that. So people should not avoid the imagery in this in these programs. Use imagination to strengthen their brain. And then there's another thing. There's different. I'll go through these quickly. But there's something called relaxation is the new strengthening, which is so much fun. So it's explaining how when you release the tension in your muscles, then you're able to reach a little higher, bend a little further. But by bending a little further or reaching a little higher, that requires more strength. The shorter you are, the closer you are to your center, the less strength is required to move you around. But when you're lengthening your body away from its central core line, your load path that keeps you from falling over, when you move away from that center load path, then that makes the muscles have to work harder to get you back up. And that is through relaxation. So again, slowly moving through relaxation will strengthen your muscles. So people that want to move really fast, they're missing out on an incredible new way of strengthening their muscles. It's even more efficient. So there's that and working in a pain-free mode. If you work in pain, you're going to not get you're going to push yourself into injuries. Worse and worse and worse. So the book has these six specific ways that you have to be aware of as you're exercising, and they will help you reverse the signs of aging. So that's it's all detailed in the book.
Yeah, so fascinating. So the slower you go, it's like operating in a mindful way, it sounds like.
Yes.
So you're,
yes.
So you have to be, you have to participate in the process because you have to be aware of how you're moving.
Yes. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. No grocery lists.
Yeah.
You have to focus too hard on what you're doing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, very
mindful.
Yeah. What are your thoughts about yoga? How does yoga fit into this model, Miranda?
Well,
or not?
It doesn't really, because like I created this program, and so I know exactly what's in this one. So it's all, the purpose of this is it's a scientifically driven program. So it's got to have the fully balanced body. It's got to be working on imagination. It's got to not stress any joints. So it's a program that's deliberately created for this purpose. Yoga was deliberately created more as a spiritual program to help center the body and calm people down. So there's a lot of movements in Western yoga that aren't in Eastern yoga. Because I was just in India and I was looking at them doing yoga and saying, that's not what I see in the West. And there's a lot of stress on joints. So there's been a whole new physiotherapy department opened up in the world for the injuries created by yoga. So that's a shame because yoga has a real purpose. It's wonderful, but there's a lot of injuries and a lot of some people, you know, different levels of yoga instructors. So some are absolutely amazing and others cause a lot of injuries. So, you know, you're not getting a standard. So yoga, I mean, I don't even like to think about it because it's complicated. You know, it could be stunningly amazing and it can be very dangerous with another person. So but I know that none of those programs like yoga, and I love Tai Chi, but that, again, was not created as a fitness program. It's self-defense. So Tai Chi never raises the arms above the head. But if you don't raise your arms above your head, then you're not going to lengthen your spine. You're not going to stop yourself from shrinking. Because as you raise your arms above your head, the arms pull on the spine, and they lengthen the muscles, all those, like, spinae erecti groups and right through into the latissimus dorsi, into your pectorals, your chest muscles. The arms above the head do that. So if you don't pull the arms towards the ceiling and move in that position, you're not going to be able to keep your spine from shrinking, and that's one of the things that happens as we age.
That is so fascinating to really understand all of the pieces of this puzzle to really optimize our body's functioning. You know, I hear what you're saying. I really get what you're saying because it doesn't have to be difficult. It doesn't have to be hard.
No.
But it needs to be mindful, and you need to know how to support all the different joints and throughout the body, which makes sense. You don't want to leave any part of the body behind, and we do that in most forms of exercise, one way or another.
Yeah, we do. And, you know, I'm thrilled because, I mean, I'm thrilled the fact that I have my own company, so I have the freedom to do as much research as I want. So I've made this program exactly what it is. It's really, really safe. Very healing and definitely helps maintain a youthful body, you know. But it's specifically designed to do that, and it's amazing that once you and science is new, so I've had the good luck, the good fortune of meeting so many leading scientists in the world who like what I'm doing and actually do my program. So they're guiding me in the latest stuff that's going on, so I can add that all into this program, brain stuff and connective tissue things and, you know, muscle changes in understanding of how our muscles function. And it's sort of hot off the shelves, you know, a lot of what we've got in our program.
Can you give us maybe an example or two of people that you've worked with or someone you've worked with that has had a, you know, remarkable recovery from working with your approach?
Oh, I mean, hundreds. We when somebody comes to work at our office now, we give them, like, we have hundreds and hundreds of testimonials, and they have to read these to see what this program is all about, because they won't understand the program if they don't read the testimonials or watch the videos. So, last week I was at do you know Omega Institute outside New York City?
Yes. Oh, yes, absolutely.
So I was giving a retreat there, and there was one woman, and her ribs had literally collapsed to almost join the hip bones. So she was sideways slumped down. There was no... So when I came up to her, and I held onto her ribs, and I pulled her upright, so she literally grew like 3 inches because she was just, her body was just collapsing into itself. And then when I let go, it just sank back down. And she said that had just happened in the last 2 years. She was in her mid-70s. And it had just happened in the last 2 years. And she was just devastated with what was going on with her body. And she had a trainer who she did weights with 3 times a week. The trainer worked with her. And she was doing all kinds of weights with this trainer, but nothing was fixing her body because the work was not on that part of the body. It was on the arms and the legs, but if you don't work there, you're not going to fix there. So we did Friday, Saturday morning, Saturday afternoon, and Sunday. So 4 classes and a whole pile of lectures. But after 2 classes only, she was able to support herself upright. I mean, she was like absolutely like flabbergasted that she could, mm-hmm. she couldn't hold herself Friday, and by Saturday she could hold herself. And ask me why, and I'll say I don't know. Because she wanted to hold herself Friday. She hadn't been able to for 2 years. And in one day of doing these workouts, she did it. And so now she's going to be working with one of our teachers in New York City because she lives there to keep to keep it up and get better at it. But, I mean, that was literally shocking to me. And I've never seen anybody change that fast. But this woman owns a major scarf importation company, and I'm getting lots of scarves.
That's a fantastic story. It's a good example because we think it's, the aging that's, deteriorating our body. And then as you were saying, she was working with a trainer, but obviously missing some critical pieces of the process.
Well, the trainer obviously didn't know. The trainer should learn to teach this program, which I'm pretty sure she's going to be. This lady will ask her because the lady loves her trainer, and she was devastated that the trainer, she had to change to get this fixed. So she's going to maintain her social relationship with the trainer, but she needs to do these workouts she saw, So she'll probably convince her trainer to teach this program because she loves her trainer so much. But,
I just want to, because we're coming to the end, I want to make sure, first of all, that people go to your website, which is Essentrics, Essentrics, com, and to pick up your book, Aging Backwards, Fast Track, Miranda Esmonde-White, because it's all there in the book.
Yes, everything is there. Way more is in the book. Way, way, way more. There's questionnaires and self-evaluations. But the book is, because there's Aging Backwards 1, that was the original book all about atrophy and connective tissue and bones, and that's the first book. And then there was the Forever Painless, which is all about pain, all different pain conditions. But this one is, again, called Aging Backwards, but make sure it's fast track. So it's 6 ways in 30 days. That's the one we're talking about today.
So if people follow the program in the book for 30 days, they will, as you say here, look and feel younger.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. yeah, for sure.
And what about videos? I mean, the book gives all the details with photographs, but what about looking at videos? Do you have...
Well, we have tons of DVDs, because I have a TV show called Classical Stretch on PBS, so we have 300 or 400 workouts from that show, and we have videos, and we have videos using a lot of our younger instructors have now made workouts. So there are workouts with me, but there's workouts with many other instructors who are, I think they're just stunning. But we also have ETV, which is Essentrics TV, and it's a streaming site, and that's, you know, when you go to Essentrics.com, up on the bar there at the top, you'll see ETV, and it's a fantastic streaming site, and you can cut off anytime you want. You don't have to do an annual subscription. You can try it for a month, 2 months, 3 months, and try out all the different workouts and see which ones resonate with you. So you don't have to buy something until you know you want it, or just stream. You can stream on any platform. I love ETV.
Well, you know, I mean, I love what you're doing. It makes total sense to me. I'm definitely going to give it a go. But,
great.
Absolutely. You know, I'm just looking for whatever is really going to support me and my body to stay rejuvenated, but also sharing the information, because we're all searching for the fountain of youth and what's really going to support us and give us the best results and optimize our health and well-being. So I love what you're doing, and I love the fact that you have videos. Often it's easier to learn when you can visually see, as opposed to follow instructions on a page.
Yeah.
So that's wonderful that you have so many of these resources that people can choose from. So I'm excited, Miranda. I'm really excited about what you're doing. It makes so much sense to me, and it's quite profound. And I'm so glad I found you. I actually haven't heard of you and your work before, so I don't know where I've been. But it's such a pleasure that we've connected, and you're sharing this with my wonderful audience, and spreading the word about something that really will make a difference.
Well, I'm so grateful for you to have had me on your show, because I'm passionate about this, spreading the word, because there is nothing like feeling good, and I know how easy it is to do it now. It's the way the body works. If you do it, the body has no choice but to respond properly. It just will, because it's a self-healing machine. It just does. It just works. You know, thank you so much for having me.
Yeah. Well, it's been a pleasure. It's just been a delight having you. I'm sure everyone has been inspired listening to you. And this is for men as well as women. So men listening.
Oh, yeah.
You know, for all of us.
Absolutely.
So thank you. So thank you so much, Miranda Esmonde-White, and go to Essentrics.com to learn more, to understand more, to see the videos, to subscribe to the streaming. Give it a go. And the book, of course, is Aging Backwards Fast Track. So great book, really big book, lots of great photos, giving the explanation of all the different movements for the entire body. So. Check it out, everyone. It'll really make a big difference in your life, in your rejuvenation process, so you can get younger and healthier every year. And we've come to the end of the show, so I'm going to say goodbye to everyone. Goodbye to Miranda. Goodbye to all my listeners. And until next week, always honor the wisdom of your feminine self. Bye for now.
Bye. Thank you.